Hello, everyone. Welcome to the service today. The Lord be with you. Those words are shared by Boaz as his greeting in the second chapter of Ruth, and so I share them with you now. We're going to turn now to our first hymn, which picks up on some of those things in the second chapter of Ruth, in which the harvests are going on, as we remind ourselves of how we can witness God in the life of the changing seasons.
Oh, the life of the world is a joy and a treasure, unfolding in beauty the green growing tree, the changing of seasons in mountain and valley, the stars and the bright restless sea. For the life of the world is a fountain of goodness, overflowing in labor and passion and pain, in the sound of the city and the silence of wisdom, in the birth of a child once again. For the life of the world is the source of our healing, it rises in laughter and dwells up in song, it springs from the care of the poor and the broken, and refreshes where justice is strong. So give thanks for the life, and give love to the Maker, and rejoice in the gift of the bright risen sun, and walk in the peace and the power of the Spirit, till the days of our living are done.
Let us pray. Your glory, O God, fills heaven and earth, and so we join our voices with those of creation, which resound with your praise, that we might rejoice in your presence, praise you for your faithfulness, and know fully your power to save and renew us. And so we confess to you our sins, trusting in your mercy and your compassion. And so, Lord, for our part in the way justice has been corrupted, Lord, have mercy. For placing conditions and caveats on your command for us to love our neighbour, Christ, have mercy. And for our hard-heartedness to those crying out for justice, Lord, have mercy. There is now no condemnation for those who live in union with Christ Jesus, for the law of the Spirit of life has set us free from the law of sin and death. Thank you, God. Thank you for this renewal. Thank you for that promise which is true. Thank you for your mercy and compassion to us. We pray that as you've forgiven us, you would guide us in renewed lives and give us the strength to forgive one another. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Today we're going to hear the second chapter of the book of Ruth. And in this chapter we're going to hear about some lives which are changed, partly as a result of the faithfulness of some of God's people seeking their welfare. And so to prepare us to hear that reading, we're going to sing City on a Hill.
Change the world.
Yeah. Ruth chapter 2. Naomi had a relative named Boaz, a rich and influential man who belonged to the family of her husband Elimelech. One day Ruth said to Naomi, "Let me go to the fields to gather the corn that the harvest workers leave. I am sure to find someone who will let me work with him." Naomi answered, "Go ahead, my daughter." So Ruth went out to the fields and walked behind the workers, picking up the corn which they left. It so happened that she was in a field that belonged to Boaz. Sometime later, Boaz himself arrived from Bethlehem and greeted the workers. "The Lord be with you," he said. "The Lord bless you," they answered. Boaz asked the man in charge, "Who is that young woman?" The man answered, "She is the foreign girl who came back from Moab with Naomi. She asked me to let her follow the workers and pick up the corn. She has been working since early morning and has just now stopped to rest for a while under the shelter." Then Boaz said to Ruth, "Let me give you some advice. Don't pick up corn anywhere except in this field. Work with the women here, watch them to see where they are reaping, and stay with them. I have ordered my men not to molest you, and whenever you are thirsty, go and drink from the water jars that they have filled." Ruth bowed down with her face touching the ground and said to Boaz, "Why should you be so concerned about me? Why should you be so kind to a foreigner?" Boaz answered, "I have heard about everything that you have done for your mother-in-law since your husband died. I know how you left your mother and father and your own country, and how you came to live among a people you had never known before. May the Lord reward you for what you have done. May you have a full reward from the Lord God of Israel, to whom you have come for protection." Ruth answered, "You are very kind to me, sir. You have made me feel better by speaking gently to me, even though I am not the equal of one of your servants." At mealtime, Boaz said to Ruth, "Come and have a piece of bread and dip it in the sauce." So she sat with the workers, and Boaz passed some roasted grain to her. She ate until she was satisfied, and she still had some food left over. After she had left to go on picking up corn, Boaz ordered the workers, "Let her pick it up, even where the bundles are lying, and don't say anything to stop her. Beside that, pull out some corn from the bundles and leave it for her to pick up." So Ruth went on gathering corn in the field until evening, and when she had beaten it out, she found that she had nearly 10 kilograms. She took the corn back into town and showed her mother-in-law how much she had gathered. She also gave her the food left over from the meal. Naomi asked her, "Where did you gather all this? Whose field have you been working in? May God bless the man who took an interest in you." So Ruth told Naomi that she'd been working in a field belonging to a man named Boaz. "May the Lord bless Boaz," Naomi exclaimed. The Lord always keeps his promises to the living and the dead." And she went on, "That man is a close relative of ours, one of those responsible for taking care of us." Then Ruth said, "Best of all, he told me to keep picking up corn with his workers until they finished the harvest." Naomi said to Ruth, "Yes, my daughter, it will be better for you to work with the women in Boaz's field. You might be molested if you went to someone else's field." So Ruth worked with them and gathered corn until all the barley and wheat had been harvested. And she continued to live with her mother-in-law. Amen.
O God of heaven, by whose hand thy people still are fed, who through this earthly pilgrimage hast all our forebears led. Before thy throne of grace, God of our forebears, be the God of their succeeding race. Through each perplexing path of life, our wandering footsteps guide. Give us each day our daily bread, and raiment fit provide. O spread thy covering wings around, till all our wandering and at our Father's loved abode, our souls arrive in peace. To thee, as to our covenant God, will our whole selves resign, and this not as a
In the second chapter of the book of Ruth, we're introduced to some new key elements in the account of Ruth's life. We've now got Boaz on the scene. We've got the barley harvest, and then we've got the wheat harvest. And connecting the two, we have this practice of gleaning, where the poor, the orphans, and the resident foreigners in the land had a legal freedom and entitlement to harvest to the edges of the fields. Alongside that was a prohibition on the owners of the fields from harvesting the edges of the fields, where they were prohibited from going back and collecting any sheaves that had been passed by, and they're prohibited from collecting any ears of wheat which had dropped to the ground. These harvests give us the time of setting of this account around April, May in our calendar, as the Passover festival indicates the start of the barley harvest, and the Pentecost festival indicates the start of the wheat harvest. And likewise, therefore, because of that, in Judaism, Ruth is read at Pentecost, because Ruth brings to life the wheat harvest in a way that some of the abstract agricultural regulations don't quite manage to do. Ruth brings to life all of that with real lives, with their emotion and drama. And all that comes to a head in this chapter through this practice of gleaning. So a question for you. What do you think of when you hear about this practice of gleaning? What is your response to that? Do you lean perhaps more to the, well, this is a really great custom for any good society to have? Or do you have some questions about its goodness? I pose that question to you because, if I'm honest, I've always heard it held up as a really positive thing. And then I tend to approach this chapter with all that in mind, expecting to read about a model of justice in society. But over the last few weeks, reading this passage again, that's not been as evident to me as it has been in the past. Let's go through that. On the one hand, this convention puts the basic physical needs of society's most vulnerable into the law. Not a suggestion, not an idea to toy with, but it is a requirement that lodges itself into everyone's minds. There is no excuse for anyone forgetting that there are people in dire situations and actually having a thought of how they may help them in their minds. Requiring gleaning prohibits the wealthiest from hoarding all the food, far more than they need, whilst others go malnourished and hungry. The legal basis for gleaning comes in chapter 19 of the book of Leviticus, alongside those famous words, "You shall love your neighbour as yourself." And this is an example of how that commandment comes to life. Those words quoted by Jesus as the second greatest commandment. And a few verses later, we have the slightly less famous cousin, "You shall love the resident foreigner in the land as yourself." All of this is very admirable. And the right of gleaning has then become incorporated in different societies' systems, legal systems and like that, as an expression of godlike love towards others. But, got to note as well, on the other hand, this is a system that allows those with means to be able to claim to have helped the most vulnerable in society without actually doing anything for them. It's possible to say, well, here's the wheat that I didn't need, that I left over, the ones that I didn't like, so I left them on the ground. And, well, you who are hungry and malnourished, well, you can come and collect them. I mean, I'm not going to come and pick them up for you, but you go ahead and collect them yourself. It's possible to fulfill the letter of the law without being moved to proactive compassion. Boaz, in this chapter, seems to offer some indications that gleaning at harvest time was far from the ideal, compassionate, merciful ideal that we might like to think it is. But while there were some who took this duty to the vulnerable very seriously, there were others who did not. Boaz orders those working his fields not to, depends how you translate verse 9, touch, bother, harm, abuse, molest Ruth. Which begs the question, why did Boaz think he needed to make that quite so clear? Naomi, at the end of the chapter, discourages Ruth from venturing to any other fields, lest she be touched or abused there. The Bible does not hide the fact that this law of justice was all too frequently abused into injustice, where the most vulnerable could be taken advantage of. And those who had plenty could tell themselves they had done their bit for justice, for the weak and the poor, by doing precisely nothing. Boaz is often held up as a remarkable, great example. And he is. We are told of how he went beyond the letter of the law to support Ruth and Naomi, because what he represents was not the normal approach. To go gleaning was to put yourself in a precarious situation. It was not undertaken lightly. And Boaz not only assures Ruth of her safety, which was not a given, but allows her to collect some of the better grain and not just the scraps left behind. Naomi is surprised when she comes back with enough for both of them, rather than them having to have a portion shared between them. What does it mean for us to actively pursue justice, actively pursue compassion in response to that which we've received from God, and not place conditions on it or abuse it in any way? John Wesley was critical of the way many people in the 18th century set about supporting those in greatest need, particularly those living in poverty. The problem for him was that too many Christians were outsourcing their help to others. They would give money or clothes or food to charities, who would then do the work and meet with the people who needed those things. He came to the conclusion that charitable aid was not to be sent to the poor, but delivered to the poor. Charitable activity that was not attended by involvement with the recipients, typical then as it is nowadays, allowed a continuation of ignorance of the situations those people were in and how they ended up in poverty, and as a result All he saw was that hard-heartedness continued, alongside unhelpful and often incorrect stereotypes about how people ended up in poverty and what their lives were like. And as a consequence of that, there was little desire from those who could do something to change the system that led to this to do anything about it. He saw people doing the bare minimum they could in his time to help those in need. And that was leading them to remain hard-hearted. I find Wesley's criticisms really challenging. But I've got to admit, I think he might be onto something. And as I read the second chapter of Ruth, I see Boaz showing the call that John Wesley puts out. Boaz's story is unusual because he actually meets one of those who is gleaning. Those in need, if they were before, are no longer a category or an idea in his mind that can be shut off, but real people with real hunger, real longings, real needs, real cries for justice. The way he expresses his concern for Ruth suggests that he knows others who do have hard hearts to people in Ruth's situation. Ruth and Boaz encounter one another between Passover and Pentecost. Festivals celebrating that God heard the cries of his people who were oppressed, enslaved, facing injustice, and that God acted in compassion to them, and then gave laws and direction for them to do likewise. What does it mean for us to actively pursue justice and compassion in response to God doing so to us? Boaz offers a picture of that, and in so doing, his heart is softened and he is changed. Our actions of justice in response to God might just change more than one person. Perhaps, though, you cannot get out and about all that easily and do that much right now. Perhaps for good reason you can't get out and meet with those who you would like to help. Well, consider then writing to someone who might be in a position to do that. Write to them for prompting. Write to them for encouragement. John Wesley was a prolific letter writer, and that's certainly one way, 230 years after his death, that any of us might put pressure on the causes of justice. It seems thoroughly appropriate, therefore, to read an extract from the last letter he ever wrote. On the 26th of February 1791, at the age of 87, 4 days before his death, John Wesley wrote to William Wilberforce, encouraging him to continue to oppose what he referred to as that execrable villainy, which is the scandal of human nature. He was referring, of course, to slavery, at a time when tens of thousands of Africans were transported across the Atlantic each year as slaves.
He wrote to Wilberforce, "Unless God has raised you up for this very thing, you will be worn out by the opposition of men and devils. But if God be for you, who can be against you? Are all of them together stronger than God? Oh, be not weary in well-doing. Go on, in the name of God and in the power of his might, till even American slavery, the vilest that ever saw the sun, shall vanish away before it." Reading this morning a tract, wrote by a poor African, I was particularly struck by that circumstance. That a man who has a black skin, being wronged or outraged by a white man, can have no redress, it being a law in all our colonies, that the oath of a black against a white goes for nothing. What villainy is this? That he who has guided you from your youth up may continue to strengthen you in this and all things is the prayer of, dear sir, your affectionate servant.
As final letters go, that's quite a powerful one. It was not an act of justice simply to refrain from having slaves and saying, well, I'm not participating in the oppression, whilst the system of dehumanisation was carrying on. It would not have been an act of justice for Boaz to permit gleaning in his fields, turning away as it happened behind his back, while the system continued of the abuse of the women who did it, who were gleaning for the meagre scraps that struggled to nourish them. What does God's justice look like today? What do you think is happening today in our lives that might be a parallel for us to be concerned with? What are the causes of justice God is calling us to respond to? That in response to and in the name of God, we would not simply step aside from injustices, but actively challenge them and the systems that allow them to continue. Let us take to heart those words from Leviticus 19. When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. You shall not strip your vineyard bare or gather the fallen grapes. You shall leave them for the poor and the foreigner living among you. I am the Lord your God. You shall not hate in your heart any one of your kin. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people. But you shall love your neighbour as yourself. I am the Lord. When foreigners reside with you in your land, you shall not oppress them. The foreigner shall be to you as the citizen among you. You shall love the foreigner among you as yourself, for you were foreigners in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Amen.
Show me how to stand for justice, how to work for what is right, how to challenge false assumptions, how to walk within the light. May I learn to share more freely in a world so full of greed, showing your immense compassion by the life I choose to lead. Teach my heart to treasure mercy, whether given or received, for my need has not diminished since the day I first believed. Let me seek no satisfaction, boasting of what I have done, but rejoice that I am pardoned and accepted in your Son. Gladly I embrace a lifestyle modeled on your living word, in humility submitting to the truth which I have heard. Make me conscious of your presence every day in all I do. By your Spirit's gracious prompting, may I learn to walk with you. Make me conscious of your presence every day in all I do. By your Spirit's gracious prompting, may I learn to walk with you.
Let us pray. Lord, we come before your throne of grace with our prayers and concerns for those known to us personally, those whose lives we've heard about in the news, and those whose situations are known only to you. We pray for the countries of the world today, continuing to confront difficult histories, legacies from the past which continue to have negative effects on people today. We pray for the response to that. We pray for the safety of those who are protesting. And we pray for the lives of all those who are caught up in whatever difficulties are being faced. Pour out your compassion. Pour out your wisdom and guidance on those in positions of leadership to know how to respond. That the story of our communities that goes forwards will be one that is more positive, more in keeping with you. As we remember the work and actions of Boaz and Naomi and the harvesters, we pray for all those who are working the land at this moment, all those who are anticipating a harvest in the months to come. We pray for all the crops that are growing, that they will be able to flourish well. And we remember particularly also those who are living with famine and hunger, that they will not be forgotten, but there will be a way that food can be found for them and delivered to them. Lord, we pray for your church today, in these islands, around the world, as your people continue to seek to find new ways of being faithful to you, new ways of meeting as your body, new ways of responding to your goodness and love, new ways of reaching out. Help us as we seek your guidance. Give us a clear vision of how we can be your people. We hold before you all those who are living with illness today, particularly those who are in hospital and unable to receive visitors. Draw near to them. Help those who are alone not feel alone, but know that you are nearby. And we pray for all medical and care staff as they continue to do a terrific work in difficult circumstances. Give them the strength and support that they need. And Lord, we pray for all who have died, their families and their friends. You would come with comfort. You would help people remember their loved ones well. Remember the good memories. Lord, these and all our prayers we offer to you in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Our closing hymn today is "By Faith We See the Hand of God," where we remember all those people of the past and today who have sought to respond to God in building his kingdom as a place where peace and justice reigns, and pray for God's inspiration for us that we would continue that wherever we are.
We will fix our lives on Him, my soul. not be moved. And the power of the gospel shall prevail. For we know in Christ all things are possible. For all who call upon His name, we will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward. Till the race is finished and the work is done, we'll walk by faith and not by sight.
Thank you for sharing in our service today. May God guide you in His ways of justice. And of course, may the Lord be with you. Amen.